Hotep community, welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Hope that you are safe and sound. And if you are not by chance safe or sound, you will become safe and sound tonight with the brother that we're going to be introducing you to the community, introducing the community to, Brother Ron Spears, absolutely amazing rites of passage expert, fascinating poet. A physicist. I just love this brother to pieces, and I'm so excited to be able to introduce him to Baba Kaaba, introduce his membership, introduce his e-course to the community. Such a gem, a treasure that is so needed in the community. Hotep to the new king, King Ron Spears. What's going on, brother?
What's going on, Hotep, brother Philippe, brother
Hotep, Kaaba? Hotep, Wakanda forever, baby.
Pleasure.
Our beloved Baba Kaaba, three-time best-selling author from three different books. His latest book, Chewbacca Stone, is just tearing it up. I am so proud, so honored to have a conversation with him online or offline or anytime. Welcome back, Baba Kaaba.
Hotep, to my brother Philippe. Thank you for this opportunity. Brother Ron. Much congratulations, much respect to you, brother. I really appreciate the work that you're doing, particularly as it relates to the Rite to Pass programs for our young people. That is returning us back to where we need to be. So I've been looking forward to this conversation.
Thank you, Brother Kaaba. It's a pleasure to be on with you. And that is high praise on a different level coming from you. So I appreciate it. And I'm containing my level of excitement. So
we can end the show with that. Hey, all right, good night, everybody. Thanks so much. It was wonderful being here. You know, it's sometimes like when one of our elders and scholars that you admire so much acknowledges your work and acknowledges that you're even alive, it's like, whoa.
Okay. I'm done. I'm okay. Good.
Yeah, exactly. That's all I need. Brother Ron, so talk to us about how, you know, I talk about frequency all the time, and you're a physicist, and so let's talk about the frequency that brought us together. How do you see from a physicist perspective, particularly an African centered physicist? How do you see our connection coming together?
Yeah, interesting point that you made there, because you know, I honestly had never heard of you or your show. And, you know, I've had this energy. I've had this gift to get out to the community. And, you know, I give the analogy of like a Bluetooth speaker. You go over somebody's house and you got your phone and you want to connect with their Bluetooth. And so you have this thing they call pair. That's just frequency. Mm-hmm. Right. So you, the person puts the Bluetooth speaker that, hey, I'm looking for, you know, future kings, future folks who can help what I'm doing. So you put in the universe what you want. And then I know what I have to offer. And I'm trying to find folks like you. And so I kind of hit my little Bluetooth thing. And then there's a certain frequency where your speaker will connect with my phone and what I have to offer. And then you hear that beep. You know, that means that, hey, that everybody can connect with that particular speaker. And so that's probably the best analogy I can make, because I honestly did not know who you were or know of you until I started, you know, sort of catching some of your shows. And I was like, man, this brother is pretty heavy. And the people that he talks to and the topics that he gets on, that's right up my alley. And so I've been searching for you, brother, and the frequency. I just have to give it up to the frequency in terms of how we connect. It's all about vibration, as you know, which is all physics, you know. And getting to know a little bit more about you and your background and your story, I'm connecting the dots now, and it just makes perfect sense. Oh. We were meant to be connected at this point, so it was just a matter of time, and that time just happened to be now.
No doubt, I totally concur. I call it frequency specificity, and obviously Baba Kaaba and I are frequency specific as well. And it's so funny. It's that everybody who comes into this family, if you will, particularly when I bring Baba Kaaba on to introduce someone to the someone new to the community, it's a very powerful thing, because we're already all on the same page, you know. How do you feel about that, Baba Kaba? Isn't that about right?
You know, my thing has always been, when you look at this concept of time and space and the time-space continuum, everything happens within time as long as you're obedient to the forces of nature. And when you follow the natural flow, when you follow that internal frequency, that frequency is attached to the cosmic frequency. And it's like instruments in a symphony. You know, when you're in tune, it's a beautiful song.
Yes.
But you can also identify the instruments that are not in tune.
Yes.
You know, and the more dedicated you are to listening for harmony and balance, the quicker you are to be able to pick out those particular instruments that are not in tune with the frequency.
And it sounds horrible.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
And for those that listen, it is so obvious, Brother Ron. You can feel it. You can see it. There's something out of sync. Mm-hmm. And what's happening is that while we are coming together, like when you told your story about coming together with our brother Philippe, the same thing happens when I came in contact with him. The same thing happens when everybody comes in contact. Everybody's coming together for a particular purpose, and the stars are lining up now. That's physics. That's science. That's not Twilight Zone.
No. You know, and when I found out that Ron was a physicist, and, you know, I'm a metaphysicist, I was like, oh, now that makes all the sense in the world. And shout out, by the way, I see Brian Bino. I love you, brother. See you out there. Amy Thibodeau Clemens, I see you in the chat. Love you, sister. Thank you so much for your support of me, Kaba, and the family. Just want to send you a shout out, let you know that you're acknowledged, that you're loved, and that you're held. Just want you to know that. When I talk about this concept of frequency specificity, and I found out Brother Ron was a physicist, and then I found out this brother is like the genius of rites of passage, and he's gone to Africa so many freaking times, and has taken kids and done all of these things. We're going to talk about that. But you're also well educated. You're a Morehouse man, HBCU.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes,
yeah. Sir. And so I'm like, dude, why are you so damn perfect? I don't like you right now. You know, like, I love this dude, right? This is, you know, this is like my avatar. Like, I would like to grow up and be one day, you know. So how did the physicist aspect in quantum physics, how did that come into your experience? Because you don't see a lot of us in physics, unfortunately. And I don't know if that is because there might be a lot of us in physics, but we just don't get the airtime, or there's just not a lot of us doing it. How did you get involved?
Yeah, no, I grew up in Detroit and Detroit Public Schools, and I went to basically one of the best high schools in the city called Cass Tech. It's a technical high school where you learn a lot about technology. And I mean, my senior year in high school, I took a year of calculus. I took a calculus-based physics class. I took a two-hour organic chemistry lecture and laboratory in high school, wow. Right? And so so I basically was sort of bred into that whole STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math space. So when I, when I started at Morehouse, I was pretty much going to go into engineering, but Morehouse is a liberal arts school. And so engineering is more like 13 blocks down the road at Georgia Tech. But so you just sort of take your liberal arts classes at Morehouse. And so I had to major in one of the sciences. So physics was just sort of the natural fit for me and my background. Mm-hmm. Now, let me tell you about physics at a HBCU. When you have those black, one of my professors, when you have black professors teaching you physics, you're going to they're going to do things a little bit differently than you would at like University of Michigan or somewhere. Mm-hmm. We had brothers telling us my first lecture in quantum mechanics was on black body radiation. And this brother was like, you know, you ever get in a room full of black people and the temperature seems to kind of get up a little high? This is why. He broke it down on the chalkboard talking about melanin and the energy that we emit. And that, and I was just like, dude, are you serious?
I know, right? But that sounds like Professor Kaba. I'm like, was Kaba teaching that class? Because right. I know Kaba's already taught that class. I know that for a fact. I have the videotape.
Right, exactly. And so you have situations wow. like that. And then to make matters even, I'm not going to say worse, but even better, you ramp it up a level. And, you know, when you get to the upper level classes, I took a class in the fourth dimension. And this professor was actually from the Caribbean, whose brother is part of parliament in the motherland. And so when you get these African and Caribbean brothers teaching physics, you get on a different frequency. And he taught a class called Special Relativistic Electrodynamics, basically the fourth dimension. All right. Wow. And in order to even take that class, there was a prerequisite. I had to take a class called Mathematical Physics, because when you elevate faster than the speed of light, you talk about collapsing time. Yeah. When you travel faster than the speed of light, that can't be replicated in any laboratory. So that's just pure theoretical. So we had to take a class in, because the mathematics changes when you travel faster than the speed of light. So we had to take a prerequisite math course to learn the different equations that are required in order to even take this class in the fourth dimension. So you talk about the Gagut equation. I was like, yo, that's tensors all the way.
No doubt.
You know,
no
and doubt. So I'm going to break that down a little bit more when I have some more time on my hands, because, you know, that brother has it on a different level. I ain't ready for that, but I'm up for the challenge to break the equation down, the Gagut equation.
No doubt. No doubt. Baba Kaba, when you hear your brethren speaking, this is your language. This is your kind of dude. I remember when I was joking earlier about it wasn't a joke. It was true. That I remember you wrote about it, and I think we recorded it when you talked about what happens when black people enter the room, melanin absorbs the light energy in the room. And I was blown away by that. You remember that? This was probably about 4 years ago, man. So talk to mm-hmm. us about that, Baba Kaba.
Well, the concept.
Uh-oh, you froze, brother. Now something's going on, because Kaba was freezing when we were doing our Q&A the other night for the webinar. So we're going to have to fly to New York and get something going on, because they targeted Baba Kaba. Hold on, yeah, well, hold on, Bob. Okay, there you are. You're back now.
Yeah, I'm back. You know, I'm going to do this frequently. So, you know, or at least when it happens, I'm coming back. So don't worry about it.
Okay.
You know, keep on keeping on, it ain't over till we win. That's just, and that is the purpose of physics.
Right.
Physics is the conversion of energy, so it's never over until you win. You just keep on going. You know, you like the ever ready bunny. You just keep going. That's how black folk are. We are physics personified.
No question.
If you look at our experience as a people, we are physics personified. Chemistry answers the question, what is matter? Physics answers the question, what makes matter move? Mm-hmm. And everything else you study out of those, be it the periodic table of elements or the law within physics, they're all trying to explain just those two simple concepts. What is matter? Right. What makes matter move? The waters of Nun and Ptah that brings forward Atom. And our ancestors had it. But Brother Ron, I want to go back and ask you a question. When you were first introduced to this brother that taught you about melanin and blackness, and that was that your first time hearing that type of lecture?
Never heard anything like that in my life, and wow. It blew my mind. Literally wow. blew my mind. That was the first lecture in my quantum physics class. Now, you know, you have wow. to, you're about 3 years in when you take quantum, so mm-hmm. You know, you get through all those prereqs, you know, the mechanics, electricity and magnetism, and then wave theory and optics and stuff. And so that's all the what you call it, the weed out classes. Mm-hmm. So this was the higher level class. So these are the folks who are really, really serious about, you know, about physics, and not people who are just checking off boxes so that they can graduate in, you know, in whatever it is they're studying. And so the class size got real small, you know, And when I talk at Morehouse and the HBCU, but at Morehouse, you know, we're talking class size of like, you know, 5 or 6.
Mm.
And so with a black professor. And so we're just digging in.
Wow.
You know, and just getting deep on many, many levels. And, you know, and I love it. And, you know, just for fun and sport, I have a master's degree in engineering. And just for fun, I audited a quantum class in grad school. I went to University of Wisconsin in Madison, which is a Big Ten school, really good school. I audited a class in quantum mechanics there. Man, it was so different. I basically just sat in just to listen to see how they taught the class. And
in what way was it different between the two, do you think?
I mean, you know, it was just following the textbook and blah, 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 blah. None of that, you know how it's like listening to jazz and listening to, you know, something that the Europeans do. It's just, you know, follow the keys and just teach the lesson plan, stay on the syllabus, don't deviate, da, 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 da. Whereas we improvise, we take something, and like you said, we just embody it. It becomes us. Mm-hmm. And that's the way classes were taught. At Morehouse, not just this physics class, but when I took classes in philosophy and religion, and especially the classes in the African origins of civilizations. You know, Chikanta Diop visited Morehouse before he, mysteriously passed away.
That's right.
And so, you know.
Were you there when he was there?
No, I was there in 87. I started at Morehouse in 87. I think Chikanta Diop came in about 85 or so.
Yeah, that's when he came. Yeah.
Remind me, Brother Ron, to have you tell the story about Dr. John Henry Clark.
Oh, my God.
Remind me of that story. But what I want to bring in is that I want to talk about what you're talking about is how important cultural specificity is. It is important for us to teach us. Mm. It's very important for us to teach us. And where did your African consciousness come from? Because it was like a perfect fit for your structure and your characteristics and traits when you went to Morehouse. But was there something preceding that?
Zero. Okay, I grew up in Detroit, which you can't get blacker than that, in a black neighborhood in Detroit, right? And, you know,
it's like me coming from Chicago. Yeah, you can't
exactly
get back into that. Yeah,
I went to an all black elementary school, all black middle school, and the high school I went to was 99.9% black, right? And the church I grew up in was all black.
Okay,
and I had never heard of any of this stuff until I got to Morehouse, right? So, but growing up in Detroit, you know, in February, even at an all black school, all you hear about is Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King, I Have a Dream. Mm-hmm. And maybe throw in a little bit of Garrett Morgan and Lewis Latimer and what have you. But it was pretty much just more surface stuff. It wasn't until I got to Morehouse. And while I was at Morehouse, I mean, that's when I first met Leonard Jeffries. Mm-hmm. Gave him a hug and felt his bulletproof vest underneath his dashiki. And his brother Marlon was security for him.
That's right.
And Frances Cress Welsing, who I know you admire a lot, met her and gave her. I mean, these are the folks that I met. You know, Dr. Khalid Muhammad, Dr. Ben Yochanan, you know, Stallings, Bishop Stallings, Kwesi, his presentation at King Chapel on the campus of Morehouse is when I first saw Kwesi's presentation slideshow about Africa. And then Dr. Ben Yochanan and Dr. Ben followed that, and Khalid Muhammad was up on stage too. And I was sitting there like,
phew. Yeah.
I called my mother the next day, was like, I'm so glad y'all had me go here.
Talk to us about it. Yeah, we got a lot to cover, but tell us the Dr. John Henry Clark story.
Sure. So when you go to Morehouse, like I said, the you take your engineering classes at Georgia Tech. And so when I was one of the lectures, once I got there, we started getting these study groups. Like I got into these different study groups, and one was like the Asar Oset Society by Brother Ra Annefer Amen, who wrote Medu Netter. So he would teach these classes on cosmology and meditation and stuff like that. And then one of my study groups, they invited John Henry Clark to our study groups. To our study group. We used to meet at, you know, just we would meet at different people's houses on Sundays or something. Mm-hmm. You know, and one John Henry Clark came to one of our study groups. And this was a point when he was, you know, pretty much whatever, 80 or 90% blind. So he had his travel companion, a beautiful young sister, you know, or on his arm, you know. And so, you know, we gave her a break, you know, and when we were done and he was just dropping it, I was sitting right next to him and he was just dropping it and just going off on us when we didn't know certain things, you know. You had never heard of this newspaper. What y'all doing? What? He was just going off on us, you know. And so when we were done, you know, he was ready to go back with his companion, was ready to take him to wherever his next venue was. And you know, we were like, hey, you know, we'll take care of him. He latched onto my arm and I walked him to the car and he held onto my arm. And I'm sitting here just trying to compose myself like I'm doing now, sitting here with Kava, you know. I was just trying to compose myself like John Henry Clark and hold onto my arm. I'm
right,
like,
right, wow. Right. No doubt, no doubt. You know, was it a part of what's fascinating is that as you get older, you look back and like, oh my God, I was a part of history. You know, because you just, when you're in it, you're just in it. But even when you're in it, you're in awe.
Yeah.
But as more time elapses and you look back and you realize, oh my God, I am supposed to do this. I'm supposed to be here. And I'm supposed to manifest this. But here's something that happened interesting with you, Brother Ron. So here you are, you know, amazing physicist. When did you graduate, brother?
1992.
Okay, so 1992. Where you are, I hope that we get an opportunity to hear something later on. You are an amazing poet. Your spoken word is just dope. And I'm looking at this cat and I'm like, it's almost like, okay, poet, physicist, African-centered consciousness. I'm like, can I check your DNA? Who were your parents? Where were you around the time? You know what I'm saying? Yes. I'm like, there's something's going on here. Talk to us about how you made the transition from physics to poetry.
You know, it's a very interesting story. Now, you know, just for the record, I'm not a physicist professionally now. I'm a business consultant.
Sure.
Physics is just what I studied in college. But, you know, so I'm in the field of management consulting. It's a very interesting story how I got into physics, got into poetry, actually. So in the management consulting industry, you travel an awful lot. You travel every week. You're on an airplane going to your clients. Mm-hmm. And when you're on an airplane every week, you rack up those frequent flyer miles. So it was a point where I was upgraded to first class every week. So, you know, I'm young in my 20s, Morehouse man. So, you know, I'm one of them dudes that drink with this pinky in the air, you know, and bougie all day in first class. Like, yes, yes. Laptop open, doing work, just basically trying to, you know, be the consummate professional. When Northwest Airlines, which their hub was in Detroit, got bought by Delta, my frequent flyer status just basically went in the toilet and I became regular. I had to start flying coach again and it sucked. You know? And so back there in coach, you don't have space to do, you know, you can't even put your laptop up. You can't get anything
right,
done.
So right.
I had these little small journals and I would, you know, you fly. You try to sleep, but you're not really asleep.
Right.
And so I was sort of upright in a seat belt in a meditative stance, a trance almost. And things would come to me and I would just write them down in my journal. And so that's that, you know, God's funny sense of humor thing, because I'm riding coach, but this is what I was meant to do, because all these things would come to me. That pineal gland is activated up there in that altitude. And I'm sort of meditating almost, and I would just write. And since I travel so much and I've been doing this for years, you know, what happened in the little journal turned into volumes of work. And so where I would travel, I would sort of just go to sort of spoken word venues an open mic and just recite, because I'm like, man, if I absolutely suck, these folks ain't gonna know me. I'm going back. So let me just try some things out and just see, you know. And then after a while, you do it for a while, you end up getting good at it and you get comfortable. It's just like Toastmasters, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Good at it. And so you do all of that, and I'm just like, next thing you know, the writing just got better, the delivery got better, and it just sort of grew from there. So I've performed in Hartford, Connecticut, at this little Jamaican spot called the Russell downtown, where Monday night was open mic night, and there was a Love Jones Experience, and I would come in every week and perform there when I was working at a client there. I've performed in Philadelphia at the World Cafe. And, you know, so it just, I just got to hone my craft a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just sort of transitioned from poetry to storytelling, because that's that West African tradition of the griot. Mm-hmm. And that's just sort of, you know, you take these books and this knowledge. I mean, you get all these books. I would take a book, let's say like Kaba's new book, which I'm enjoying reading, but I would reduce it down to a 3-minute poem.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause, you know, everybody, you know, some of our folks, they don't have the attention span to read like that. You know, but they'll listen to something and hear the vibration and the rhythm, and they'll get the message. And so that was sort of one of the things I was trying to do, is just sort of get this knowledge down to a little bit of a bite-sized rhythm of energy and vibration, so that it can connect with people where they are. So that's kind of how it started. And you know, it's at a point now where I just transferred into sort of digital storytelling. I put imagery with the words, and in other cases, I you know, I pretty much you know, I don't really perform a whole lot nowadays. I like to just capture the stories, and mm-hmm. so a lot of these stories don't get lost, you know. And that's the important piece of it, because those stories can live on. You know, people are not going to sit and watch 3-hour YouTube videos of you and Leonard Jeffries and James Smalls and Kaba. You know, a lot of times people don't have the energy. I can sit and watch y'all.
Nope, that's not true. I got to correct you on that, because we have done 3-hour shows with Leonard Jeffries.
I watched all 3 hours.
Nobody left.
I was mad when y'all cut it
increased. It's crazy. I didn't even know I had that kind of audience. But it's like when Leonard Jeffries comes on, and we have, especially when we do like ensemble, you know, like, yeah. Open the Shaka, Leonard Jeffries, Baba Kaba, Professor Smalls. Just by the fact that, you know, Leonard Jeffries can go. So that was a 3-hour show. It was absolutely insane. But to your point, yeah, most people don't have the patience to do that. And so and particularly young people. So when you put it into a 3-minute poignant, powerful, rhythmic cadence of the spoken word, it begins to have its own frequency. It begins to have its own vibration, and it begins to really land. Now, with all of these gifts and skill sets and core competencies that you had amassed, where did it begin? Where you went to Gory Island? Where, and you started a rites of passage program? You started taking kids from a church. And you went, I don't know how many years in a row. It was absolutely crazy. I saw some video, because your video, your e-course goes really in. And I'm like, this dude, where has this dude been? Everybody needs to know your name and who you are. Talk to us about how did the Africa component start taking shape while during the poetry?
So the rites of passage actually became before the poetry. Mm. So I was, when I graduated, like I said, when I left Morehouse and Georgia Tech, I went to Wisconsin for grad school in engineering. And then I came back home and started working and consulting. And so I was traveling a lot. And when I'm not traveling, you know, I was pretty much, I just got married. I was so busy working and stuff like that. And I kind of got a little bit away from what we were taught at Morehouse with leadership and service. So I went to the Million Man March in 95, and I just got overwhelmed. I was just like, and basically you left there. It's like, you have an assignment to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so I basically wanted to find an organization where I can give my talents to. And what ended up happening was there was a brother. I didn't start this rites of passage program at my church. There was a brother at my church who was a fraternity brother of my dad's. And my dad took me to his retirement party. And as a retirement party, he talked about he was going to be spending six months of his time in Africa and the other 6 months here. And he was going to be starting a rites of passage program at the church that I grew up in. Mm. And so I was just like, sign me up. And so, you know, because of my Morehouse background and my Afrocentric knowledge, I became the chief teacher for the young boys who go to Africa. And so and that's at the age of 13. And so that's where I was involved in the program. So each year for about 5 different years in a row, we took a different group of boys to Africa. So since he was over there for 6 months out the year, he established a relationship with a village over there that still practices this tradition. When I say over there, I mean, this village is in the Gambia, which is on the western coast of Africa. Mm-hmm. And so this is a village. I mean, this village to this day, I was just there like maybe a year and a half or so ago. They still don't even have electricity to this day. It's crazy. Wow. And but they still practice rites of passage, you know, and so that's kind of how this got started. And rites of passage, just so the community knows, there are 4 stages of growth and development in our life: birth, rites of passage, marriage, and death, where the family and community comes together to celebrate. So, of course, we have christenings when you get born. You come and celebrate getting married, and you come and, you know, celebrate life at a funeral. The missing element in our culture is the celebrating the passage from boyhood into manhood, from girlhood into womanhood. And so that was the missing element in our society, maybe on purpose, Lave, you never know. But we were able to find a village in Africa that still practices that, and they allowed us to participate in that ritual. So boys from Detroit and girls would march into the bush with boys from the village who were also at the age of passage. And we would go into the bush together, and you just can't even, you know, describe it. You know, it's a secret ritual, so I can't share what goes on in the bush. But, you know, it's part of instilling that culture into the kids. And it's part of this, my free e-course, I share. This was back in the 90s. We were doing this back in the 90s, you know. Mm. So a lot of these boys that I took into the village are now 35, 36, 37 year old grown men. And I share interviews with them talking about that experience and how it has impacted their life now. Because a lot of times when you think a 13 year old kid doing something like that, they're not going to remember that. Please. Wow. Yeah. Transformed their lives.
Wow. Absolutely.
Some of them went to Morehouse, some went to Howard, and they're married now with kids, and they can't wait to take their kids to Gory Island. So, you know, and that just melted my heart, and that just said, hey, this is what it's all about. This is why we're doing this. And we're, you know, chalk up one for the culture.
No doubt. No doubt. just want to have a quick moment of silence. I just found out that DMX has transitioned.
Hmm.
Ashe. He is an ancestor now, and he is with us. So, Baba Kaba, when we've had so many conversations about not just rites of passage, but the importance, the necessity of rites of passage. But we don't really have, most times we think of it as just, we got to go to Africa to do it. We don't have anything here or anyone teaching it in a particular way to be able to do it. When you hear, talk to us about the importance of rites of passage and why this brother's work is so relevant.
Well, to me, in my experience in the education, we do have rites of passage or rite to pass programs. We call them graduations.
Okay.
But what we do is, the Western perspective of growth comes from what they consider to be intellectual. But from an African perspective, growth comes through the spirit. You don't have like kindergarten graduations, you know, and fourth grade graduation, eighth grade, high school, college. It appears from an African perspective, that your graduations come from conception. That's a rite to pass. Then when you're born, that's a rite to pass. Then when you're 2 to 3 years of age, that age that people call the terrible twos are really the terrific twos. Because at that point, 2, 3, 4 years of age, a human being has been told what to do. They just do what they're supposed to do. But then you get to a certain point where there is a spiritual manifestation where you say, okay, yeah, ma, dad, okay, okay. Why? Okay, you tell me what to do, but why? Explain it to me. And so that's a spiritual manifestation. There is something within that has come out and said, okay, I embrace that. I accept that. I trust you. But now explain to me, why am I doing this?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Where does it fit in my life? And then, as Brother Ron is saying, when you get to be 7 or 9, what I've noticed intellectually, looking at the work of people like Barbara Sizemore, Amos Wilson, Wade Nobles, Asa Hilliard, I could go through the list, Adelaide Sanford, all the scholars that talk about education.
When Jawanza Kanjufu.
Jawanza Kanjufu, you know, the conspiracy. Something happens that you are at a pre-reasoning state, and then you go to a reasoning state, 7, 8, or 9. You're at a reasoning state now, because if the adults have administered to that spirit properly when you were 2 to 3, and they've explained to you why you're doing what this is, what is the purpose behind the mores, the morals, the way in which we do things? Why do you do that? If you respond to that spirit, the next spiritual growth is going to begin to synthesize in their minds all of their experiences, put it all together, and figure out a way as to who they are. That is a point that should be. But now, when you get to 12 or 13, 14, when you have the power to reproduce yourself, when your hormones are raging, when you're in the seventh grade, when you don't know if you want to crawl, walk, fly, you know, swim, and sometimes you want to do all of them at the same time.
Right.
That is the rite to pass that ushers you into that next very important plateau. Because when you can reproduce yourself, when the young men can produce the spermatozoa that can reproduce themselves, when the young ladies can produce the egg that will become the future womb of the world, there is another type of spiritual manifestation that takes place. And when we looked at the Grand Lodge of Luxor and we saw how the temple was built according to these spiritual manifestations, then you begin to see that this is part of life. And if you don't go through this, then there is a serious crippling of your life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then when you're 19, 20, 21, there is another type of manifestation. The same time you're supposed to be graduating from college. But that's not how Africans looked at it. These are not intellectual manifestations. These are spiritual manifestations.
Mm-hmm.
Spiritual not being religious. Spiritual meaning invocative, invoking within to come out. So when you say physics and you say metaphysics, physics came out of metaphysics.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to ask Brother Ron, because I was really feeling, that's why I asked you that question about when you first heard that concept of black drawing energy. What you just described is evidence as to why we must educate our own people.
Mm-hmm.
No doubt. Period.
Period. That's it. People say to me, well, brother, you sound, you know, can white people teach black children? And I say, I have met phenomenal teachers of all different cultural backgrounds. My thing isn't that they shouldn't teach black children. I say we black people should teach black children. There's a difference. I ain't got nothing against you. It's just that you're doing what I'm supposed to be doing. That child needs to see me. And Brother Ron, I would imagine when you not only heard this information, but saw who was telling you this information. I mean, that's just mind blowing.
Yeah.
It comes back to our brother, Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson,
mm-hmm.
who studied under the tutelage of Carl Sagan from Cornell University. And he tells a story because they say to him, about, you know, his mentor being a person of European descent. And he said, look, you have to understand that when we as people are in areas where we do not have a mentor that look like us, it doesn't mean we stop studying what we want. It means that we just have to substitute someone else for what we should have. So now Neil deGrasse Tyson, Ron Spears, they are now examples of Black excellence in STEM. And so it becomes important that when even you talk about the poetry, I've often said in the Board of Education, everybody talks about STEM. Okay, we break subject areas. Communication arts, which is really spiritual sciences, but we'll call it communication arts, physical science, social science. Performing arts includes communication arts includes performing arts, creative arts, and language arts. Art is inside communication arts. In math, science, technology, and engineering, I say you teach STEAM, but you must envelop it around, you teach STEM, but you must teach STEAM.
Absolutely.
Because everything we know about every major civilization, even our own, comes from their art. Everything we know about Kemet with the pyramids and the Tekkenus and the Shabaka stones and all these things, we see it through their art. And so art must become an attachment to the science, the technology, the engineering, and the mathematics. And the way I did it in class was, if I gave a child a math problem, let's just make it simple. Mm-hmm. And I gave a math problem, and some of their math problems was 2 + 2 = 4. Part of their homework was to drill and to continue, but I also gave them an assignment. I want you to draw that formula. Because what I did is I made them go over into their right brain. I made them take a left brain concept and take it over to the right brain and represent the left brain analytical mind with the right brain's analogical mind. So therefore, that cross-reference, you're making it happen. And in our children, we have to always be cross-referencing it. So I am not surprised at all that Brother Ron would be interested and successful in poetry, because how else do you express physics than through art? Through formula. It's there. And so I'm, you know, as I'm listening to Brother Ron talk, and I see it is only natural now for him to take that genius and now give it to the children from his perspective, so that they don't have to grow up like Brother Ron and Brother Neil deGrasse Tyson without a representative in that area that can come up underneath your wing, which Dr. Oba Tshaka talks about apprenticeship.
Jerry So, Benny So, Bolo So, and So Dai, and So Dai. You know, when I see what you've done, Brother Ron, in Africa, I see the Dogonic entrepreneur or mentorship process and apprenticeship process. Talk to us about this e-course that you put together. It's a video e-course. It's intense. It's wonderful. It's beautiful. It's magical. It's got poetry. It's got, you know, spoken word. It's got video from your trips to Gori Island. Let me ask you this before we even get into the e-course. What, because you have a poem about going to Gori Island. What was that experience like for you the first time when you went?
Yeah. I mean, you know, most people, African-Americans, if they're conscious, they have a bucket list to go to Africa.
Yeah.
Right. And so, you know, when you go to Africa as a bucket list, you can go, you know, most people want to go east to see the pyramids.
Sure.
Go south to see where Mandela, you know. Mm-hmm. But if you choose to go west, why beat yourself up and see slavery, you know, see where slavery
is. Right. Right.
But if you choose to do that, let me warn you, you're going to come back real mad.
Right.
It's gonna be a rush of emotions, both emotionally positive and emotionally negative at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. you're going to instantly connect with your ancestors. You're going to feel their presence, that welcome home. But when you walk through a place like Gori Island or El Camino in Ghana, I've never been to Ghana yet, but I'm getting there. But I'm sure it's going to be the same thing. When you walk through these slave dungeons, you know, it's going to hit your spirit in a very, very, you're going to be pissed. You're going to take the week off after, if you work with, you know, you're going to have to take the week off.
You probably can't be around white people for a period of time, too. You might have to just kind of really go into a whiteout at that point.
Yeah, but the unique thing about me, because see, the Gambia and Senegal are very close to each other, like Detroit and Chicago, right? So so we would always take the young people from Detroit to Gori Island before we go to Senegal, I mean, to the Gambia for the rites of passage ritual. So that's the reason why I went to Gori Island for like five times in a row. Okay, and each year that I went, I experienced a different set of emotions. I went from anger, okay, to the second year that I went, you know, they have the, you know, the brother who gives you the tour and tells you the story. The first year, I didn't even hear a word he said because I was just like, you know, it hit me a certain way.
Sure.
So the second year, I was able to at least process what he was saying, you know. Wow. And so it you just kind of go through a different set of emotions. And so I just sort of summed all five of those different emotions or each year, all the way from anger to celebration, because we are the only people who can go through this door of no return, become enslaved, and then come back hundreds of years later as tourists. We are the only ones who have the strength and the fortitude and the sacrifices in order to make that. And I fully understood that and appreciated that. And so, you know, but to be able to capture and bottle up those emotions into a 2.5 minute poem, that's something, like Kaba said, when you put it into that art form, that's something that can last for generations and tell stories and keep this tradition alive for generations to come.
No doubt. No doubt. I'm putting the Ron Spears free Sankofa 5-day module leadership video e-course in the chat for the family. It's also in the in the description. If you're on Facebook, it's at the top. If you're on YouTube, hit the show more and it's on the bottom. But I'm also just putting it in the chat for people to be able to experience that, because you know what was powerful about it, and I don't know if you got a chance to see it, Baba Kaba. But what was powerful about, I felt what you were feeling through your spoken word. I felt those emotions. And it was almost as if, particularly with the visuals, it was almost as if I was right there with you. And when we talk about frequency, you cannot not feel some kind of way when you have what we call, what's now being called the Ron Spears experience. So talk to us about the e-course, because the e-course is about overcoming obstacles. It's about spirituality. Why did you decide to develop this and produce it in such a formulaic way?
Sure. Sure. And, you know, it's been a great week for brothers named Ron. So, starting with Ron Isley, everybody on this Ron Isley kick. So I'm trying to keep that energy going. You got the gray beard there, but I don't have the beard, the gray, but, I got the name. So, but that, you know, the e-course came again. This is sort of going back to me being the engineer that I am. When you have all of this knowledge, you have to sort of organize it into a way in which it can connect with people. And I was in graduate school in studying engineering. I took a class and, you know, the class was based on this certain equation and it just stuck in my head. Okay. And so I basically organized this e-course according to that equation. Because the engineering process is all about taking what you have in terms of raw material, putting a little bit of, you know, something on it, preparing for what could go wrong, okay, and then basically trying to use that to self-correct and produce a desired repeatable outcome. And so that is how I basically organized this free e-course to kind of walk through each of those different steps. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, that raw material is self-knowledge. Once you get that knowledge of self, man, it transforms your life. It, you know, it changes your whole outlook on things. But you can't stop there. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You can't be on the corner talking about all this and your life is raggedy. You can't do that. Right. You can't stop there. So the next CLAT module is on spirituality, because our enemy has done their job well.
Yeah. And we have to acknowledge that. Their job
well. They know what they're doing. And so we have to connect with this African center spiritual principles in order to counter the obstacles that are facing us. And so that's the module 2 and 3 is the spirituality and obstacles, because that is the constant battle that we are fighting. And most of us are losing that battle. Even if we think we're winning, we're losing that battle. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so that is the modules 2 and 3. Now, if you choose that spirituality over the obstacles, then module 4 is self-improvement. That's when the Shabaka stone, the Memphite theology, that's when that self-improvement, you can actually start to transform your life, right? And so the 5th and final module is life skills. That is where you are actually focusing on your family, focusing on your children, focusing on your career, focusing on your health, and more importantly, down the line, you're laying the groundwork for a legacy. Okay. Mm-hmm. Saving for retirement, you're living a vibrant lifestyle. You're operating your life within your purpose, and you're doing things that are going to advance the community and not just doing things to advance yourself. Advancing yourself is important because you want to leave a legacy for your family, but you also got to leave your legacy for the family, for them raggedy folks that ain't taking care of their kids. So you got to help them too, And so those are the types of things that you have to focus on. So that 5th module is on life skills, and that's just basically living in your purpose and having a wonderful lifestyle as a result of that. So, if you do some self-knowledge, you're just missing the point.
No doubt. Margaret McCall, I'm going to put you out here, Margaret. She says, how many hours is the e-course? It's about 5 hours, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it's five modules, and each module is anywhere between 30 and 40 minutes long.
Okay.
So it's not quite 5 hours. It's more like 2.5.
Fantastic. And it drips over a 5-day period of time when you subscribe.
Correct.
So, Baba Kaba, have you had a chance to experience the e-course and some of the modules that Brother Ron is sharing with the community?
Yes. I've seen the self-knowledge and the spirituality, overcoming obstacles, self-improvement, and the life skills. And I had some questions because it was deep. I was really getting deep, and there's one in particular I want to get in deep. But if I may, I'd like to return back and ask Brother Ron a question, because I think this is important. Because, you know, Brother Dr. Edward Bruce Bynum, he talks about the fact that the original human, the African that developed himself throughout history, that came through Homo sapiens sapien, and then even touched on becoming a super sapien, or what Dr. Richard King calls a Homo perfectus. They went through a cycle of life that everybody else hasn't gone through. Indo-Europeans have not been through what Africans have gone through. Mm-hmm. We have millions of years of experiences in our DNA, deeply rooted in our culture. And although they are ethnic stocks and mutations of us, they have not been around that long. And so Dr. Edward Bruce Bynum talks about the 6 dimensions. And he talks about the first 3 are what we experience, the 3D, length, width, and depth. But when you combine those 3, when you compress them, because those are characteristics of time and space, but when you condense them, you move to the 4th dimension, which is the time-space continuum. The fifth dimension is you then start, once you graduate out of that, you then start to walk in light, and then you leave your footprint in the cosmos, which the sixth dimension is called gravity. Dr. Clark used to tell us, Brother James Smalls used to always tell a story about when the mastery of Dr. Clark being a teacher is that James Smalls talks about being in a lecture with Dr. Clark where he was talking about Shabaka, talking about Shaka Zulu. Okay. And he said the way in which Dr. Clark spoke about Shaka, it was as if Shaka had come into the room. Okay. Now, I'd like to go back to what you said with Brother Ron about when you observed something that he was doing in one of, I believe it was probably one of the lectures, where you felt like you were right there with him when he did it.
Absolutely.
Now, Brother Ron, for us to understand time, space, continuum, because like you say, so many of us have not moved through this process. When I read my brother Edward Bruce Bynum's work, when I'm reading your work, you know, we are all exposed to concepts that we don't understand. But there's something that I'm looking at the time space continuum, and I want to ask a question so that I can get your response. The reason why Dr. Clark was able to make the people in the room, particularly James Smalls, feel like Shaka was in the room, and the reason why Philippe felt that he was there with you was because Dr. Clark's genius and your genius to express something literally collapsed the time-space continuum where they actually were with you.
Absolutely, 100%.
And Dr. Clark actually made it so that Shaka appeared in the room.
Absolutely.
To me, that's what the time-space continuum is. Mm-hmm. Please, my brother, let me know a little bit about what we're talking about here. I just want to get right where we got to go.
Love it.
Brother Kaba, Baba Kaba, it is a gift. It is a gift that I cannot claim responsibility for.
Okay.
Okay. It is something that is taught. You know, as I'm connecting the dots now, it probably has a connection of course, those physics classes that I had, which kind of expands your mind beyond 1 + 1 = 2 into more higher level thinking, because thinking is everything. Yeah. And when you get into those higher order physics classes, it stretches your mind like nobody's business in terms of the ability to think and go beyond, you know, sort of concrete things to more abstract. And so it forces you into that. And so, you know, as I connect the dots, I can't answer your question without connecting the dots, because I don't know where this came from myself. But I've asked myself that same question, and this is sort of where I'm connecting those dots. So between those classes and then the meditation workshops and cosmology workshops, where you learn how to meditate, okay, and sort of, you know, commune with the ancestors, right? And then when you get into the process of serving others, it's layers to it that brings you to that point. But the other thing that I am blessed with that people tell me, because, you know, when you talk, you don't really hear your own voice. But I was told that I have a really cool voice. Right. And when I do my own meditation sessions, you hear the vibration of my voice. And you close your eyes and you listen to me help you through difficult situations. You listen to me explain things. The video that Philippe was talking about is me at Gory Island. I did a music video the last time I was there about a year and a half ago. I did a music video on location at Gory Island, and I recited the poem. And basically, the vibration of my voice, the depth of my lyrics, and the visual of being at Gory Island, that is something that somebody 300 years from now is going to be able to connect, who will never, may never step foot. Here's some folks in Detroit that ain't never went north of 8 Mile. But if they watch this video, it's like they were at Gory Island. And if you can't put something together like that, poetry or spoken word wise, that can connect with people from a vibration standpoint, then don't even bother putting pen to paper. I hate to do that, but since we're talking about DMX and we trying to honor his life, don't even put pen to paper unless you can write something as deep and powerful as that. And I hate to be blunt like that, but you know, it's a lot of pretenders out here that don't have the ability to connect with people. It's a vibration. I can't it's a gift.
Let me ask
you. Isn't that the primordial waters? Isn't that what you talk about, Baba Kappa, all the time? That when you are frequency specific to the waters of Nun, Ptah, and Atum, you're just going to naturally manifest.
It's the pattern in the tabernacle. Let me ask you this, yes. Brother. Mm-hmm. When you tell the story about 300 years from now, when somebody watches your presentation, listens to your vibration, experience the visuals, 300 years from now, was never anywhere near you physically, wasn't anywhere about Gory Island, never been Gory Island, don't know where Gory Island is. But if you do it in such a way that 300 years from now, they do become part of it, have you not, through time, space, continuum, brought them there?
Well, hey, it's like the it's like that age old you know, with the twins going off into space. One twin stays on Earth, the other twin goes off into a rocket ship, and that rocket ship travels beyond the speed of light and returns to Earth. Those two twins are no longer the same age.
Okay.
When you meditate and you are able to basically travel through those cosmos, time changes. And so I can go forward and back. Okay. But the vibration is, the frequency is the same. And that's why we are connected with our ancestors from many years ago, which means we have the ability to connect with our ancestors many years to come. And all right. So it all comes full circle. It's like you say with the Sankofa, the slingshot, the further back you put, the further more it goes. That's why this is called the Sankofa Leadership Experience, because we got work to do, brother. And we got to do this work. That we got to stop messing around.
No doubt. Seriously. No doubt.
But everybody doesn't have a gift.
And we've got to understand that we must take command and responsibility for our conditions.
Absolutely.
And to have that professor at Morehouse be able to drop that on you, and just your neurons were different. They connected differently from that point on. They could never connect the way they did before. And even went to someplace and audited a class in quantum mechanics, you knew that horn was out of tune with the symphonic revolution.
No doubt.
Yeah. You know, by Mandrill, symphonic revolution. They were out of touch with that. And that's part of our problem, because we're walking in the earth. We are like whales that are living in goldfish bowls. But we think there's something wrong with our lungs because we can't breathe. It's not wrong with that. You just got us in the wrong pot. We need to get out.
Something's wrong with black people. Something happened to black people.
Get us up out of that cup. Return us back to our original ocean, the moon.
Absolutely.
One of the things that a lot of people don't know, and I could just speak for Morehouse and Spelman, but a lot of people don't know, and this is probably the same for HBCUs across the board, but 70% of the students that go to Morehouse and Spelman are what we call Pell Grant eligible, meaning they come from households making less than $40,000 a year. Okay. And you come there and then you just literally, we call the come up is real. You get transformed and you go off into the world and do these great things. You know, like I said, I have a Zoom call every Friday night with my Morehouse and Spelman classmates from 1987, right? And 2 weeks ago, Raphael Warnock was on there because he's, you know, in the fall of 1987, Raphael Warnock, senator in Georgia, was at the W.B. Du Bois Hall right across from where I was at, the Howard Thurman Hall dormitory freshman year. And we got some scholars in my class, and the come up is real. Reverend Warnock grew up in the projects in Savannah, Georgia, and now he's the pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta and senator in Georgia. Came to Morehouse on what he says a full faith scholarship meeting. His parents dropped him off and gave him with no money.
Full faith. Love that. Genius.
But there are so many people just like that.
Yes.
And the debates that I've had in the basement of Thurman Hall, you just priceless. So the come up is real, but you got to connect with these young people and their frequencies, and you have to nurture that and find a way to turn that frequency and nurture that into, you know, the genius of our mission, leadership and service.
Talk to us about that, because you we were talking and mentioning Dr. Leonard Jeffries and his model of politics, economics, and culture, the pyramid analysis. Translate that to what this program is able to do and be able to answer, particularly for our young people.
Sure, sure. Well, the foundation of all of that is culture, you know, and so that's where you start early with the rites of passage. You get them while they are young. You connect with those frequencies while they're young. You recognize it, you connect with it, you shape it. And then once you, as you sort of, you know, kind of grow and you start to sort of develop, that's where those life skills, the economics and the politics, as you grow through a career, through saving money, through supporting businesses, and you understand how that works, that covers the economics part. But like Dr. Claude Anderson says, man, you got to get to the different levels in the building to, in order to, he says, buy your way into the politics and your influence there. And there's, you know, nobody knows it like him. He definitely understands how this thing is played. I'm not a fan of politics. I just put my head down and do the work. But, you know, that's one of the reasons why we're in this condition we're in, because we're not paying attention to how the game is really played.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why it is important. And I acknowledge and respect the importance of it. And that's where it's just a beautiful thing when people who you know, because when Senator Warnock, not when Reverend Warnock was running, our class just really rallied behind him. And then you got Stacey Abrams, who's Miss Spellman right now, you know, was just rallying. You understand the type of influence that we can have. She got folks doing crazy things in Georgia right now because they scared of her, right? And so you start to understand. That's where it's like, I can tell you, but if I show you, I think you'll understand a little bit better. And that's the Stacey Abrams effect. And so you start to understand what we can do politically and the type of power that we can have, that closes the triangle that Leonard Jeffries has been talking about for decades. But you got to start early with the culture. And then as they grow, then they have the mindset to support Black businesses, to support Black colleges and educate their own and support Black businesses and keep those dollars in your community so that you can have that political influence and understand the masses and have that unity that has been eluding us for ages. And so this free e-course, and more so the membership, it goes through all of that in terms of instilling that culture while you're young. Okay. And then the parents and adults are going to learn too, because, you know, we got some catching up to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so it's a great thing for adults as well, especially when you want to teach the young people, teach your kids, okay, about these things so that they can grow and become what we need them to be in the future. So, you know, I still have my paperwork, my handouts from Leonard Jeffries back in the 80s at Morehouse on the campus, talking about the triangle and all my ASCAC Association for Classical African Civilization. I have all of my pamphlets and all of that. but it really is centered around that triangle: politics, culture, and economics. But you got to get them young. Otherwise, when you get old, it's hard to teach old. You know, anyway, you get what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Got to get them while they're young.
Well, talk to us about the. Oh, go ahead, Babakawa. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I know. I just want to return to your fourth module, self improvement.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you rang a chord with me, brother. You touched something real deep with me.
Oh, wow. A lot of people don't have that ability, but wow, I'm humble.
Oh, but Brother Philippe will know what I'm talking about. Brother, talk to me about the importance of the number seven.
Ooh. I wrote a whole poem about that. It's in the module.
Okay.
About the power of the number seven.
Oh, yeah.
Folk, we have seven portals in our bodies.
Okay.
Two ears, one mouth, two nostrils, and, you know, the mother two down there. 7 days. I mean, the number seven is that mystical number. It's the number of, you know, transformation and stuff like that. So I talk about numerology in the modules as well. But that number seven is definitely that number, you know, with completion. And, I wrote an entire poem just about the number seven. All of the, you know, whenever I write a collection of poetry, there's always seven chapters. Whenever I do a spoken word project, there's always seven tracks. And my life skills module, there's seven modules for young people and seven modules for adults. You know, when you make that transition from youth to adults, the seven modules for young people is your parents, your belief system, school or education, hobbies, and then the peer pressure, sex, drugs, violence, you know, and peer pressure. So that's the seven modules for youth. When you transition and mature out of your youth into adulthood, then the next seven modules for adults are your career, getting married, having children, and then the stress of those three alone over a span of 30 to 40 years can take its toll on your health. So those are the four modules of adulthood. And then you get to the three of being an elder, of money, because you're no longer working. So how are you supporting yourself financially? Lifestyle, what are you doing with your time now that you're no longer working? And the legacy. So those are the seven modules of and this is part of the membership, not the e-course, but the curriculum with the membership is based on those seven modules for youth and seven modules for adulthood. And so all that is by design, because, you know, I'm intentional like that. But I have a poem in the e-course about the number seven, and it breaks it all down.
Let me ask you one more question about the fifth module, life skills.
Yes.
What is your concept of grown man style?
Well, it's an acknowledgement that the women right now are just killing the game. They are on top of everything. These brothers are falling behind. Mm-hmm. And we got to teach them. You know, they're growing up in houses, led by our sisters, and they don't have that strong male voice to tell them the real about things. And so, you know, we kind of have to bring, again, it's about if somebody don't do it, you got to do it. I have to just basically say, this is what grown manhood is all about. Okay, because we got to teach these young boys what it's like to be a man. And the sisters are going to love it too, because they were looking for some real men too.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So it's not just a lifestyle. Grown man style is my lifestyle blog. And it's based upon the five wells of a Morehouse man. Okay, which is coined by one of our past presidents, Dr. Robert Franklin. A Morehouse man is a Renaissance man with a social conscience who is well-read, well-traveled, well-spoken, well-dressed, and well-balanced. So those are the five wells of a Morehouse man. So those are the five aspects of grown man style.
Say them again, please, brother.
Well-read.
I'm sorry, say again.
Well-read.
Okay.
Well-traveled. Well-spoken. Well-dressed and well-balanced, that work-life balance thing, family.
Fantastic. Wow.
So those are the five wells of a Morehouse Man that was instilled in us by one of our past presidents. And so I based my lifestyle blog, grownmanstyle.net, on those five categories. And so that's where, you know, well read, I mean, my library is enormous. You know, I was blessed to have a full scholarship to Morehouse. So, and same thing with grad school, which came with a stipend. So I was able to just buy a whole bunch of books. And my library is enormous. This didn't just happen. I read a lot. And through the work that I do, I travel all the time. And so I'm able to, that expands your scope and your purview of the world so much when you are able to travel the world and see different things. Well dressed, you know. You know, it's that the whole drip style. You know, we like to drip. We like to look, you know, look good.
Gotta have that swag, baby.
You gotta have that swag, right?
Gotta have that swag. That's
well spoken. I mean, you know, spoken word poetry, but more so that influence. Like you said, you gotta have the ability to influence people with your words of power, because words have power. Words have vibration. Words have meaning. But words can also really, really destroy. And we have been destroying our boys. We have been destroying our women with our words. We've got to do better. You know, we've got to focus on that. And then the balance thing, that's that life skills thing. You got to have that work-life balance. You can't just be all about work and you're just neglecting your kids, neglecting your community, neglecting your relationships in the pursuit of trying to get that paper. You know, it's all about that balance. So that's what Grown Man Style is about. It's basically going to be an online community to help, you know, teach these boys how to be men, and the women who are looking for their young and grown men, boys, to be men.
Absolutely.
And what it's all about. So that's part of my mission as well with the lifestyle blog.
Now, your membership, you got 52 weeks that you went crazy, dude. You went all freaking in. I mean, like, damn, who does that kind of, well, a physicist, who's a Morehouse Man, that's who would do something like this. You developed a 52-week membership. Talk to us about the Ron Spears Sankofa experience, and what can the community gain from enrolling in this 52-week process of rites of passage?
Sure, yeah, and I have to credit you for the whole concept of the membership, you know, because I have so much I've developed so much content over the years. You know, you just can't just put that out in a book or something.
Right.
And so you introduced the concept of a membership to me. And I'm just like, 52 weeks, man, please. What? When I put a spreadsheet together and I started filling in each week, I was like, oh, damn, he's right. And so, you know, because people can't absorb everything that I have to offer.
It's too vast.
It is. It is. And so
you shared with me all of your curriculum, all of your, I was like, brother, yeah,
you
brother.
Just missed it real quick. You were like, bro, no.
Yeah. I'm like, no, we gotta put this in dosages. There's no way. I mean, you know, you're looking at 20, 30 years of knowledge all wrapped up. And then, so yeah, it had to be put into a, so go ahead, Brother Ron. How did you put it together?
So again, the free e-course is literally just that. It's a course. It's like that teaser trailer, right, for what you're going to get. But the membership is the actual curriculum. So it's me rolling this out week by week. Each week, you're going to get a different piece of information. And it's part of the curriculum. So the curriculum includes, it starts out with my documentary.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's going to get into a lot of different things. I get into the art of storytelling, and I interview people who are master storytellers, and they talk about the importance of telling your stories, getting those. A lot of people say, "Man, I had so many books in my head." Like Kaba had all them books, right? The Spirituality Before Religion and Chewbacca Stone. He had those books in his head for too long, And it there's so many people with that exact same situation. Mm-hmm. You got to get it out of your head, get it down. And if you don't even get it down, just tell the story.
Mm-hmm.
It, it breaks down the art of storytelling, because a good story is no more than like 10 minutes long.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And it gets the emotions. It gets people engaged. So I get into the art of storytelling. The main thing of the membership is the curriculum, so that you can teach people those 7 modules that I talked about for young people and those 7 modules for adults. So there's a now, you know, because I teach for a lit or my profession is in organizational change management. So basically, which is about communication and training, helping people to learn. So each module is 1 hour long, which has some reading material. It has my spoken word. And all of my spoken word is no more than like 3 minutes long. So because, you know, people don't have attention spans.
Mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's by design. Again, it has some self-reflection. It has some discussion. And it's some lead-in questions for discussion. But the key is that meditation piece, because we're dealing with that trauma. And we got to overcome the trauma from our past.
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
That's where I have... The last module of rounding out that 1 hour, each 1 hour module is just listening to my voice and the sounds of nature, going back into your past and dealing with unpacking whatever issues that you're dealing with and focusing on overcoming those issues and not letting it stop you from being successful and fruitful in the future. So each curriculum, each module of the curriculum is 1 hour long. And those 7 modules for young people and 7 modules for adults. And that's how each module is broken down. And it's the participant guide, and it has a facilitation guide so you can teach others. Because like I said, we're not ready. So we've got to teach them. So there's a facilitation module as well with a learning objectives. You know, Kaba knows this about, you got to have a lesson plan. It has
mm-hmm,
a
lesson mm-hmm.
plan and all the things that you need. So that's part of the curriculum that's rolled out each week. And then in between and off weeks, when I'm not talking about the curriculum, that's the storytelling piece and the interviews, which sort of add credence to those modules where I talk about the importance of different things. I introduce the community to people special in my life that have really deep knowledge and conversations that we have about growing up and about making sacrifices, about the various topics, health, about marriage, about life, about mm-hmm. different things. And so it just gives people different perspectives on things. And so, you know, and so I didn't really realize it myself until you sort of said, bro, you can't do that in one thing. That's a membership. And yeah. And when I filled out the spreadsheet of 52 weeks, I was just like, wow, he's right. He's right on point. And so that way it's not as overwhelming. You just each week you just sort of, you know, absorb it a little bit. And by that point, you know, because I say the 400 years, you know, they got a little bit of an extension. We're beyond those 400 years.
Mm-hmm.
That extension is needed because we ain't ready.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right?
Bobby, you talk about this all the time. What are we going to do?
Yeah. It's the bottom line. Responsibility is 2 words, not 1. It's the response to your ability. It's action oriented. Once you know better, you do better.
Mm-hmm.
And your first day, self-knowledge, is, of course, the cornerstone to all the other day. If you can't get past the first module, the other 3 or the other 4 ain't going to do no good, or the other 6 if you're doing the 7. Self-knowledge is the key to all things. Then comes self-management, which is self-discipline. And when you know yourself and you know how to discipline yourself, then you can know other people.
Mm-hmm.
Which is social knowledge. And then after you know other people, then you can manage other people, which is leadership.
Mm-hmm.
But self-knowledge is at the base. You must know yourself in front of all the temples of ancient Kemet and Kush in the Greek language. Coming from the African language, they said, Sethon Nothi, Sethon Gnothi, know thyself. Before you even enter the temple, know yourself, because what's going to get you in the temple is that you know yourself and you want something better for yourself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Know yourself. When you know yourself, then everything else falls into place. And our challenge, we don't know ourselves. Dr. Diop says, the three things people will take from you when they wish to oppress you. This has nothing to do with the culture. This is just in general. They take your history. They take your language. They take your psychological factor that Dr. Jeffries calls your values, your interests, and your principles. And then they superimpose their history, their language, their values, interests, and principles on you so that whatever decision you make will never be in your best favor because you're not looking at the world through your eyes. I ain't got a problem with Europeans looking at the world their way. You have that right. That's your eyes. But that ain't my eyes. So don't try to make me see the world through your eyes. I want to see the world through my eyes. When you do that with self-knowledge, everything else opens up for you.
Beautifully said. Beautifully said. Baba Kaba, talk to us about the importance of membership. You know, like when I talked to Brother Spears, and I said, you know, from a digital nomics perspective, this needs to be in a membership, needs to be dripped out every week, similar to what we do with the Comedic Wisdom School. The content that's in the Comedic Wisdom was actually three plus years of content. You can't put all of that in one thing. It has to be digestible. It has to be put into a dosage. How is that? Talk to us about the importance of that, Baba Kaba.
It's life. That's life. When you look at the way the Comedic educational system was put out, you began as an initiate. You became an apprentice. You became a son of light, S-U-N of light. In the Dogon, you were started at Jiriso, then you went to Beniso, Boloso, Sodai. In this world, the way I do it, and I give credit to Dr. Oba Tshaka. In the beginning, when I first met Dr. Clark, I was an imitator. The way he carried his bag, I carried my bag. To this day, I still enjoy okra and tomato because he enjoyed okra and tomato. You imitate the master teacher. But then there comes a point in your life where you realize, yeah, the master teacher is the master teacher, but you also have your own personality. Mm-hmm. So you blend the two. You synthesize the two, and that's the level of the assimilator. You assimilate the greatness on the outside with the greatness on your inside. And then once you get to that level and you graduate, you then become an innovator where you begin to do things that neither of you did before. And so when you're looking at membership, you graduate through it. You build on same way with neurons. When you get an information in your brain, neuron, it goes from neuron to neuron to neuron to neuron. You know, you played the game Post Office where you tell a secret to somebody and then it's passed around the room to see... And very seldom does the last person have it the way the first person said it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But that's how your neurons work also. And sometimes you can get a mixed message on the way to your consciousness. So the membership allows you to walk through the process. And when you're dealing with someone like Brother Ron, who carefully has mapped out his development, he knows what he's doing. So he knows how to take you step by step through this mm-hmm. process. Membership is absolutely important. And you see, the other thing, Philippe, the good thing about what you do in terms of the work that you do, the Philippe Matthews Show, and my own personal experience with you over the past 6 years, is because you told me the same thing. Brother Ron, he told me the same thing. He said, no, you ain't ready. He told me that.
Why are you telling all of our business like that, Baba Kaba? Don't be, you know. You got nerve. I don't want Ron to think. I know, like, who the hell you think you are? You know I'm Baba Kaba, bro. What are you talking to?
Hey, right now, I'm trying to get, you know, Ron to realize that, you know, he told me the same thing. Mm-hmm. And you were right. You were right. And when I look back, I know you were right. But see, you were looking at it from your expertise. That's not my expertise. But because I listened to you and I did what you said, I was able to extend the program out to do what I did on my e-course. Mm-hmm. The e-course. See, a lot of people say, vote for me, I'll set you free. But what we're saying is, here's something we're going to give you for free. We ain't even asking you for nothing. Mm-hmm. Check it out. Because if you like this, wait till you see this.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
No doubt. It ain't no game with people.
Right.
You know, this is straight up education. This is education, the way, that's why you go to school for so many years. That's why you have a membership in school when you first go. You didn't get everything the first day in kindergarten. Right, they have a process.
Great point.
And that's what these memberships do. They bring you through a process with what we call the least restrictive environment, which is the cornerstone to our special ed classes.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody deserves special ed.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody deserves an individualized education plan. But the reality of it is that everybody learns at their own pace, in their own way, under their own temper, tone, and taste.
Mm-hmm.
And when you can get a scholar that can speak to you, recognizing those different facets, that's not telling you, know this the way I'm telling you to know this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just laying out the format, know it the way you know it.
Mm-hmm.
Because you do know it. You were born with this knowledge. All I'm doing is facilitating that you recognize that you already know this.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that's what the membership does. And that's what Brother Ron does.
That's the definition of education, bringing out, drawing out what's already in you. And that's what frequency does.
That's it. Because it's in you. It's in you. That's why you dance. You know, when you were talking earlier about knowing the difference between them and us, you know, what came to my mind immediately is understand what you're experiencing with Soul Train and American Bandstand. That's the difference.
Oh, you're going to bring it back. Oh, my gosh.
That African funk.
Absolutely.
The African funk. And that professor that was talking to you in those days when he expressed that in Morehouse about Black energy, he was bringing the African funk into that classroom.
That's right. That's right.
No doubt about it.
Study with them, you in American Bandstand.
Right. Right.
But when you study with us, you in Soul Train, love, peace, and soul.
Best way to describe it. That's why I call it the Ron Spears Sankofa experience.
That is it.
Because it's an experience. Everybody is into experiences, not just a thing. When I went to Georgia Tech and Wisconsin, that was a transaction to get that paper. Morehouse or any HBCU is an experience.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, an experience you would never forget. That's why just look at the marching bands at HBCU versus, you know, a PWI.
Mm-hmm.
It's an experience.
Mm-hmm.
The best way to describe it. Our people are into experiences. Mm-hmm. And that's why my membership is called the Ron Spears Sankofa Experience, because it's taking you on a journey.
No doubt.
And go ahead, Kaba.
No, I was just going to add to what you said. That's why Black folks say, I feel you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And when they say, I hear you, they're not talking about your physical ears. They're talking about your third ear. When they say, I see you, they're not talking about your two physical eyes. They're talking about that conscious third eye.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And that's how we operate. And that is what HBCUs bring to that experience. This ain't no lecture. This is an experience. This ain't no class. This is an experience. Because when you leave here, you will be a different person.
No question about it.
The person that came in the room ain't the person that's going to leave.
That's right.
It's something that's going to blow your mind, Kaba. You know, I'm physics all the way, right? But my daughter is a freshman now at Hampton studying chemical engineering.
Mm.
And she has got the left brain, right brain, the art, the STEAM thing down at 18.
Wow.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, she's got the periodic table in her room. And but, you know, because that's what it's all about. It's about, and that's why, you know, it took so long for this to come out, because I'm focusing on my family. But now that they grown, they don't want to listen to me no more. So I'm like, I need somebody to listen to me, because my kids don't listen to me no more. So that's why I'm like, Philippe, you got to connect me with your community, because I need somebody to listen to me. You know, so that's just the reality of why I'm like, okay, I'm feeling empty right now. I need another audience, you know?
Right.
That's the whole timing of this. And the other thing too that I didn't mention about the membership is I go into detail about how we connected with this village in Africa to establish his rites of passage. Because, you know, it's like you go on vacation in Jamaica and you're at your resort and all that. And, you know, you say you always want to go connect with the people, right? No, as soon as you leave that resort, you put your life at risk if you don't know what you're doing, mm-hmm. you know. And so we had a guide, and I have the guide who's a brother from the village who connected with us and connected us to his village. I interview him in, I don't know, week three or four of the membership. And it's a 2-hour discussion. And he breaks down how we connected and rites of passage and all of that. This is a brother from the Gambia who now lives here in the States. So we have that. And I lead all the mission work in Africa with my church. And we basically break down how we are doing mission work. We put in a $60,000 water, pure water system there. So because women, when I was going there, I would notice women carrying multi-gallon jugs of water on their head, walking like 300 and 400 yards to take clean water to their families. And that's crazy. And so we put in a clean water system there, and I managed the project. And now they just got to walk about 20 or 30 yards to a tap. And so the women in the village are loving me right now, you know, because, you know, that's using the resources that we have at our church in Detroit, you know, where we got some high net worth individuals with this automotive money, right?
Right.
And you know, again, the power of persuasion, we get them to donate money to this cause, and then we're able to tell the story, which gets more donations to come in because they see what things are doing. Mm-hmm. And this is a Muslim village and a Christian church. It don't matter. It's God's work for God's people.
Mm-hmm.
It's what it's all about. And so I go into some of that as well, and why we need, that's leadership and service. That's what it's all about. And so the membership does storytelling, it does the curriculum, it does how to start this types of rites of passage program, how it started, how to do mission work in Africa, and you know, basically living a successful, fruitful quality of life, operating within your purpose and leaving behind a legacy so that the culture can move on.
I am so honored by our frequency specificity. I'm so honored to be able to not only attract geniuses in my life, but to be able to see how to synthesize and package their genius to share it with the community, because Baba Kaba and I have this conversation all the time. A lot of the scholars, including myself, we crazy. We just cray cray. And so sometimes we start talking and we understand what we're saying, but sometimes it's like, okay, I need a translator up in here. This is what did you just say? What kind of, so to be able to see the genius, and like you're talking to me and I'm getting it. But I'm saying to myself now, if I'm new in the game, if I have a lot going on, this might be overwhelming to me. And what happens with us particularly, even in internet marketing business, they teach you that if you give too many choices, nobody's going to make a choice at all. Right. So like when you put up a web page and you've got, you know, your About Us tab, you got, you know, your courses tab, you've got the contact tab, you've got research tab, you got, it's too many choices. Nobody's going to be able to make a decision because it's too much information. It hasn't been synthesized. So what I teach people how to do is to take all of that website, all of that knowledge, and then drip, go to one thing, which is a squeeze page, that is just an email address. No other decision can be made other than putting that email address in. And then everything that was on the website, you drip it out over a period of time. What happens is that now you develop a community as opposed to just a visitor to your website. So the genius of Ron, when I saw what he was doing, and I think we met, I don't know, two or three times, and you started sending me stuff. Hey, take a look at this. Hey, take a look at this. Hey, take a look at this. And I'm looking at it, and I'm like, oh, this is, I'm like, okay, now 3 days later, I'm still looking at stuff because there's so much stuff to look at, right? I'm like, whoa. Okay, let's drip this out. This is how we're going to do it because this is too important for it to be overwhelming to the community. They got to have this information. I always look for missing links, missing pieces of scholarship, things that help fill in the blanks of the current scholarship that we have. And when we're lucky to have something that is just completely, you know, in a sense, brand new, like Baba Kaaba's Shabaka Stone. Baba Kaaba's the first in the world to write an actual book dedicated to Neferkare Shabaka. Nobody's done
Neferkare.
That. Yeah. And so as a result, I'm like, okay, how can I get this information in the hands of the people that need it the most? Put it into a package that people can afford, because that's the other piece, right? I could easily, and I remember, you know, working with cats that this kind of project that Brother Ron has, that's a $50,000 program. That's easily a $50,000 to $100,000 program.
I was about to say, you cheapen my stuff, man. This
is right. I know. I kind of lowered the price on the value on it a little bit, but well, maybe the first 6 months. But anyway, so how do we get this information to the people where they're able to digest it, but also to be able to be transformed by it, and then be able to share it and reproduce it in a way in their own personal lives that moves them to a completely new level of frequency? And that's what Baba Kaaba was talking about in terms of you are not going to leave, hopefully, the Philippe Matthews Show or the guests and the people that we have on the show. You're not going to leave the same. You're not going to leave out the same way you walked in. You're mm-hmm. going to grow. That's the goal. Every time I come out, that's the goal. Grow beyond your current position in knowledge, self, and life. And then we all live in that first frequency. Brother Ron, I'll give you the second to last word. Of course, I'm going to give it to Baba Kaaba. But in closing, your thoughts.
Yeah, no, I just really appreciate the journey from how we met to where we are now. And quite frankly, a lot of what's yet to come.
Yeah.
You know, one thing, the last thing that I will say about that is also part of my membership is, and I've been listening to Kaaba for a while now, and I know I love hearing him tell stories about when he was a teacher in the school system and how he connected with the students.
Mm-hmm.
One of the cool things about me being the head of this Rites of Passage program is I've maintained a connection with the students who are now adults. And what if Kaaba was able to connect with some of the students that he influenced to see how they're doing now? Well, I've done that. I'm interviewing them on Zoom, and I'm publishing some of those interviews in this membership so people can see
what this is. Basically, a before and after, huh?
The before and after. Wow. And we took the girls. The girls used to go to Egypt. The program was called Kentucky, based on the Kentucky Queens. And their what they used to recite each Saturday morning was the principles of Ma'at. Right. Mm. And then when tourism got a little crazy in Egypt in the 90s, they started coming to West Africa with us. Mm-hmm. And so now I'm sharing interviews with some of the students who, and they're doing really great things now. You know, all of them are still, you know, everybody comes on their own in their own way, but I'm at least they remember everything that we taught them. And one thing that I'm noticing is as gifted as I think I am, as great information I think I have, the thing that made the biggest difference on them was just my physical presence in their life at that time, more than anything that I may have said was secondary. And I realize that now, and I take you know, I take all humility in that, and that is what it's all about. leadership and service. And that's what the membership is. I thank you all. I'm humbled to be on the show with Kaba and all the words and questions that he asked me, because those were some heavy questions, which gives me a little.
You're a heavy brother. That's what that means.
Yeah, it's giving me every little bit of validation that I need. Not that I need validation, but hey, we all like a little bit of a back end compliment every now and then. So, brother, I appreciate you. I appreciate both of you on many levels, and I'm just really, really happy to be part of this community now. And I have big plans. There's a whole lot more in me that is not even part of this membership, including the Shabaka Stone book, Brother Kaba. It has inspired another book in my head right now about the waters of Noon that's about to come. It's in my head. It's about to drop down. So, brother, you are inspiring on many different levels, and I appreciate you like nobody's business. So thank you.
Wow.
My book is going to be called The Waters of Noon.
Oh, wow.
I love it.
The love Big it. Bang physics wow. meets anyway. You hey.
Oh, I can only imagine.
Wow. I can only wait. I can't wait. Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
Baba Kaba, last words.
Well, you know, Brother Ron, you have demonstrated, you know, just our discussion here, you have demonstrated each one reach one. Because I go back to that conversation that you had with that professor at Morehouse.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He did for you what you're doing for all those who are in your program. Mm. Each one reach one. We're passing this baton constantly. And there are great things ahead for us. And I want us to always remember that. And Brother Ron, last night I received your email and I emailed you back. And going over your program, I took a whole bunch of notes. Going over your program, I was envisioning what this conversation would be like. And I was elevating it to levels of great ascension, brother. But I got to tell you, it was better than I thought.
Wow.
It was higher than I thought. And I so appreciate.
Don't do that to him, Baba Kaba. Don't do, because I got to work with this dude. I don't want to have to. Oh,
brother,
damn.
Brother John.
Right?
Yeah. My brother Ron, let me tell you something that Dr. Oyibo taught me.
Yes.
He taught me to own my greatness.
Yes.
He said, yeah, okay, you know, you don't have to flaunt it. You know? But there's something about our people. They want to see us standing on our square.
Right.
But they don't always want to hear us telling them, I'm on my square.
Right.
Humility and being humble has its place. It has its place because no matter how great anyone may be, it doesn't mean they're greater than somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
It just means they realize their greatness. And when Dr. Oyibo used to say, own your greatness, own your greatness, I came to realize that's what our ancestors did when they sat on thrones with gold on their head, wrapped in gold all over their body, eating the foods of the land and creating the dynasties. They liked to live good. They liked wealth. They liked health. They liked to love and be loved. And there's nothing wrong with that. And brother, you've got a package that you are a change agent for our future, because you're with our children. And people always said to me, do you see hope in the future? And I always ask, do we have a kindergarten class coming in? Because as long as we have children, we have a future and we have hope.
Mm-hmm.
Keep on keeping on, realizing it's not over till we win. Our ancestors, Harriet Tubman, did not do what she did for us to be like this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
She saw a time beyond us, and we talk about good old days. Black folk ain't never had no good old days because we ain't never had no good days. How can you have good old days if you ain't had good days?
Right.
Our good old days are in the future, and we're going to get there because we are destined for that. And I thank you for all the part that you played. Service you, to brother. The community is leadership, and we lead by example. And Philippe.
Yes, sir.
Brother, thank you for all that you do. Because
it was nothing.
You know what Dr. Oyibo said, right?
Right. I know.
Listen, You are our mouthpiece. You are our microphone. Because right now, Brother Ron and I would be just talking to the air. And since his daughter is in Hampton and our children are out the house, I'm talking to myself if I'm not talking to my wife. You are our microphone that allows us to speak to Dennis Taylor and Brian Beano and Margaret McCall. It is because of this. So I thank you, brother, for all that you do. Together, we're going to make this happen. In fact, it is happening as we speak.
Real talk. Facts.
Fasten your seatbelt. Where do you see 2021?
Wait until you see. We're tearing it up. Thank you, Brother Zach Carter. I love you, too. Miss you, too. Got to see you on the Q&A next time. All right, family, you know what to do. And Brother Brian Beano, love you, too, brother. See you out there. Like, share, comment, but take action. Don't just kick the tires. Buy the car. Let's make it happen, family. We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live.